thematic one. It's the fourth session in our symposium entitled Resilience Through Architecture Building Technologies. I'm going to give a brief presentation on our speakers today. The chair of the session is architect Y.L. Sorry. Chair of the session today is architect engineer Y.L. Sabri, who is a practitioner in the community architect and planner with 20 years of experience in Egypt with national and international consultancy firms, community organization technology centers, international experts, and craftsmen working for multi and cross-disciplinary projects of urban planning and community development in vernacular and historic contexts. It's also providing professional and technical assistance in disseminating appropriate technology as an approach for community building and craft development. He's a founding member of the Egyptian Earth Construction Association, completed his diploma and master in vernacular architecture at Oxford School of Architecture in the UK, and bachelor degree in architecture in Cairo. And now he is managing 10 green technology innovation networks on sustainable building. And then our first speaker would be Professor Dominique Müller. And she is a French architect and author who graduated from the École d'Architecture Paris-Tolbiac, in 1985, and received a master in wood construction from the same university a year later. She lived in Stuttgart for 25 years with her German husband and their children as a major prominent sustainable architecture with focus on building in wood and earth. She gives talks all over the world. She has written numerous books on these subjects, among them a few translated in English. On architecture and urbanism, wood houses, sustainable living, and a regular contributor to several European publications. She's also chief editor of the French magazine Ecologie. Her teaching activity at the École Nationale Supérieure d'Architecture and the University of Stuttgart focuses on sustainable and integrated development in architecture and urban planning. And our final speaker will be Professor Ingo Fendtag, who is working under the umbrella of the DAD since 2008. He was a professor at the German Jordanian University in Amman until he joined us in Ain Shams University this year in September. He is also contributing in our ISD program as one of our staff. He's focusing on building techniques and design. He began teaching at the Technical University in Dresden in 1993, where he also organized academic contacts and exchange programs worldwide. Prior to running his own office as a licensed architect in Dresden, he worked at well-known offices in Graz, Austria. Continued travel affords opportunities to follow his cultural interests and the respected architecture approach. So now, I hope you enjoy this very interesting session, and I give the floor to you.
Hi, everybody. You know, I'm French, and the French like to make revolutions. A few years ago, I discovered this sentence from Albert Einstein. It is not possible to solve problems with the way of thinking which created them. Resilience, which is our subject, is about adaptation. How ironical it is to speak about it in this context. What's wrong? The size of the room, the temperature, even if it is better today, and also the way we sit. Concerning the size of the room, there are two answers. The first answer is that when we do it next year, we perhaps let it free for the students, so that more students can get a profit from all the very important persons which are coming from all over the world that will make our footprint a little bit better. The other way concerning the size of the room is that for this afternoon, you please all come very near to us so that we get the impression that we are a community, because every speaker spoke about collaboration, working together, speaking together, and everybody is prayed out. So please, and then we will get also a little bit warm. So let's change it. And now Wael will speak as it was planned.
Actually, we will not start before having you in the first seat, please. Please. Thank you. Actually, I started to work in GIZ recently, like 06. And when I joined the team, I was amazed because I found a book on the shelf called The World of Words. So GIZ and such organizations has loosely, a very big one with different abbreviations, terms, and expressions. And I was actually overwhelmed. I started to know about everything during the first 1 year, the first year. Actually, it's just to know what we are talking about. But actually, I have the same feeling when I got the invitation to the conference, because I don't know what is the meaning of resilience. I started to look at everything, and then I got some idea. Actually, we have 57% of the Cairo population living in illegal settlements, while 44% of this built-up area is illegal as well. And this is the map, actually. And I was talking about these red patches, that this is not resilient, and these are the resilient one. Actually, I'm questioning this because with full resistance from the government, these people started building, and they lived for a long time, and they are continuing building. And actually, I see them also something we can learn from. On the other point, we have 95% of Egypt is not populated, inhabited. And we are starting now to think about these areas. Even we are looking about these areas. Yes, big population, but actually we have to think out of the box. Situation is can be seen. This is like an Egyptian canal. Can be seen as really severe. This is really rubbish, dirty, and so on. But also can be seen that it has the potential for change, really for rectification and recovery, because we really reached the limits. And the only way to do this, to know exactly and to believe that this is like a very small point of time, in time, that we see this lake like that. While we have longer times, we see difference. we have different. Actually, when we talk about sustainability, because really resilience for me is really a very, very strange term. When we talk about sustainability with its very famous diagram, we talk about something really. What's this? Sorry. We talk about something like a tool to think and to build our environment, to build our environment, and to generate solutions that really goes with these three bubbles: environmental, social, and economic. But not only, but really to search for integrated solutions. It means that we have different solutions that really interlock with each other. Not only this. Actually, sustainability with the diagram is very static. We have really to think that every element in the environment does not work by itself. Actually, with the relationship, interrelationships between different elements actually can form a system. The system should be having an objective, a goal, processes. Definitely, resilience is built in the system. There is nothing called system without resilience. So resilience or this regulation, self-regulation ability is part of the identification or the definition of a system. Actually, any process started with input-output, then processes. It can be having like regulation, hierarchy, also interfacing with others. Actually, we can work and talk about every single point here to really understand how it works. But actually, this will not be sustainable. So the system is doing a function, and we need really the function to be sustainable, or like the solution should be sustainable at the end of the day. But it's not like this only. Actually, the system itself should be sustainable. So the system which generates the solutions should be also sustainable, in a way. The only way to do this is through like a control mechanism, definitely. Definitely, we have feedback. We have center control, control center, and really to think deeply how it works also is really needed. Innovation at the heart of everything, and this is so obvious to know that there is no resilience without innovation. Like a community has to have the ability to innovate, and when they have the ability to innovate, then there's no problem. So the idea was really to create innovation networks that work in a multidisciplinary and multi-stakeholder approach, really to work together. Also, Dominique has said this in the beginning of the session. Actually, I thought that it would be great if we can have different format of the conference. Definitely, thanks very much for the invitation, thanks for everything, your tremendous efforts with the team, everybody. But I do really push for example, bar camps. I do push for like beyond any recognition camps, or we can do really even like auto-hosting techniques like open space circles and so on. So really, this is very important also to say. So innovation should be in the process, also in the product. Innovation, a lot of innovation. When we started this, like we had like 1,000 idea. But how exactly we can choose between them? So we had this small tool to see exactly how it is innovative, and then to see exactly how it is ready for the market. And with these two criteria, we have this diagram. So when we have it here, so it's really potential innovation for Egypt. iHouse Innovation Network is one of these innovation networks, really the framework innovation network. Actually, we started different ones, and we started then iHouse Innovation Network. This is for affordable, resource-efficient housing. And we found out that even iHouse Innovation Networks are generating really another networks. We'll see how a little bit more. after all. This is the model of the innovation network. It has definitely pilot companies. Not only pilot companies from the supply side, but also we have some members from the demand side. We have research and development institutions, we have service providers, because these research and development institutions, the maximum target is just to publish a research, but we need really technology carriers. Also we have advocacy parties, like associations, chambers, and so on. And we have, at the core, the objective of the innovation, the objective of the system, actually, the goal of the system. So the goal of the system was really 40% risk cost, but not only economic, but affordable and really socially accepted. So Mustaqar is an idea, and what we are trying to say that really we have to Arabize, Egyptianize our thoughts. Mustaqar is an Arabic word and it means settlement, or like a place that people really can live in. And actually, when we think about that, we think that the heart of the city should be innovation hub, innovation heart, innovation core. And definitely, the whole thing is really interlocked. So when we talk about, for example, any techniques of building or systems like biogas, different ecosystems, then it should be really integrated within the plan from the beginning. This is not really a plan or that plan, it's just one of the plans that we can really look at it. But actually, when we go to the details, we have been to take the system analysis that we have seen before and try to figure out which system could be more resilient, have more resilience than the other one. So, and again, could be that open spaces, as also part of the speakers was talking about, that open spaces really can do a lot in shaping the city and really keeping the city healthy. Or that the energy, that every parcel in the city should be a whole, because one of the system's characteristics is that the system is a whole. So if we want really to have the parcel as a system by itself, then the parcel should be a whole. Or really to think about landscape as part of the whole system, and to see the landscape, not really amenities, but really infrastructure. And we have seen the presentation yesterday about really the same idea. So thinking about really weaving the infrastructure with the aesthetic values inside the city. Also about mixing uses, mixing social classes, social groups in the city could be also very enabling for resilience. For example, this neighborhood is totally different with the class, social class, than this other two. But really, I'm even promoting more, even to interlock the social class and social groups inside the one system, the smaller system, as small as we can, to integrate as we can be successful more. Actually, when we talk about also the disintegration of the subjects in the conference, and that's why the art of hosting techniques is really brilliant, because everybody's standing together. So people talking about institutional setups and how really it affects also landscape, and everybody should be in one circle, not different sessions. So when we talk about environmental simulation, environmental design, we have to definitely, as you know, all you have to start from the planning scale to the smallest design and detail. Exactly, we go through design, but this is not the point. The point is the qualities that we want really to insert. And this all should be done with the community. So you see here the integration of everything. You see the materials, you see how the environmental design really affected, but also you see the optimization of the cost of the building. And I will go through this some of these innovation networks later to know more about it very fast. And to we are not here talking about concepts only, but what we want to do is to get the community the opportunity to choose from alternatives. Actually, we have this talk with the Academy of Scientific Research and Technology, and the Academy is really a district of having real solution on the ground, not only concepts. So we discovered, we studied different techniques, earth cast. We had we are in the validation process now, but the cost, for example, is 117 Egyptian pound against, for example, bricks, which is 330, and even the stone is really higher in cost. Another innovation network called the Trifty Wood Innovation Network, and it's about really using or utilizing the cotton stalks that should be burned every year in open field burning to cut the cycle, the life cycle of the worm. But actually, turning this into renewable material, fully renewable material, could be a way out. Should be also taken into consideration in our design. This is the beams, for example. Also, we are in the validation process, and we have to say that the square meter will cost 90 pounds, while the square meter in this reinforced concrete will cost around 200 pounds. Definitely, you have different techniques. I'm here not really to show you different techniques technically, but really to highlight the possibility of having renewable material, ecological, socially oriented, and economic techniques. We have 50% of that technique saving. We have this technique also commercialized in Egypt, so one can really go and purchase it tomorrow from the market. This is one. It will cost around 120. Actually, in this innovation networks, we are really not reinventing the wheel. We are just collecting and assembling different parts and different innovations around Egypt. And we have a lot really. We don't have a problem in creativity, in individual creativity. We have a problem really in assembling these creativities. Definitely vaults and domes, we have saving 75%. In total, easily we can reach 30% cut of the cost for the conventional than the conventional building. On the other side, the solar water heater, for example, the energy. So we have really to work on two things. When we talk about green technologies, we have to talk about product development and market development. Actually, even in Germany or any other part of the world, the government really intervene and put efforts really to promote green technologies. And we cannot really think that in Egypt it will go very fine with the free market mechanisms. So we had really to convince people that it works. Everybody is winning. So we have to develop some economic modeling, then really to build up a national program for promoting solar water heater, and then even to think if we have return of investment period 5 years, then we have really to think about product development to cut this cost. Yes, we have it 5 years, but with our new Egyptian solar water heater that is in the pipeline, we could cut the cost by a third. Cut third of it. Actually, biogas in Egypt started in the 70s, and the problem with this that nobody institutionalized the solution. There's no commercial model. There's no business model really for biogas. Nobody really selling biogas in Egypt. Only professors going from work from a place to another place needed to install some biogas in some areas. Definitely, we have in Egypt, we have the technology, but also with HHO cell, we can really make it more reliable. So both techniques can have return of investment about 5 years and reliable. Gas will not run off. Grey water, definitely one of the technologies. There's another innovation effort on grey water, and this system has been innovated in Egypt. This system for one residential household, this one for 8 residential households, and it's very crucial in Egypt. But the water still tariff is very low, but when we think about, for example, market segments like Red Sea resorts, we can start with. Even we can export you to Jordan with 3 years return of investment. Definitely black water, you can visit in any time. Also these kind of prototypes and projects. This is in Valley Sweep in Yaqub village. This is constructed wetland that really running till now. And then also we have another technique, which is really compacted units. So for wastewater treatment, but also can be managed by the community, and this is the most important thing. Actually, Yaqub village started the project, and another village joined them. 60% saving. It means that every person will cost in the conventional system about $300 in Egypt, and this system costs around $160, $170. If the government really is intending to do 1 million residential units during the coming three years, and actually you have seen the idea of the HPRC really to do this nice village conceptually, I wonder how we can make this without thinking out of the box. So developing sustainable community is a survival strategy, as we cannot afford other strategies. Re-engineering the process definitely is not the solution. Really, you have to go out of the box. Conventional methods cannot generate out of the box solutions, definitely, as we have the statement of Einstein. Multidisciplinary is not an ornament. It means we are talking about multidisciplinary, but really we have to do multidisciplinary. Innovation networks and open sourcing is the only shortcut for future or the future in Egypt. Actually, we cannot really stand or like sit in one room like Microsoft and try to go beyond what Microsoft gone. But we can do as definitely as open source techniques. Individual creativity exists, as I said, but innovation management is the missing component, and this is what we are offering in this innovation management or innovation networks, is really to help people and really to teach people, or even to learn from people how to manage networks, multidisciplinary networks. Some of the people we have them in our networks, I don't know about them. Even I knew about some of Egyptian intellectuals and innovators in building and green building from foreign members, from foreign friends. So networking is really vital. National strategy for sustainable housing and community building is needed now. And actually, I'm also it is very strange to think about PLEV as pilot project while we don't have a strategy. Why we can't put our hands on a national strategy. Part of what the Egyptian Earth Construction Association is doing, actually, is they are part of urbanization and environmental design pact, or like sustainable development pact, and we are submitting a proposal for some articles in the constitution. Really, we cannot let it go like that. The strategy committee should host, facilitate, this is really the, and because I hear today, the idea of having resilience it has to do with institutional, governmental institution. It is not NGO's thing, but I totally disagree. Actually, when we have a system that has NGO's, civil society, and has the institutions, the governmental institution, all stakeholders, they should be really part of the same system. If we just like neglect one of the parties, this will not give us any potential. The other thing, I have a nice joke actually. Why the elephant cannot ride the bicycle? Do you know why?
Too heavy.
Too heavy? No, this is really conventional. Out of the box, please. Why?
Because it cannot ring the bell.
Exactly. It has no small finger to ring the bell. So this is really impressive. So actually, governments cannot do it alone. They cannot do this except with civil society. And actually, I can tell you that it was more successful with a nice photo of the canal, a very old photo of the canal, very clean and nicely done. That really the state was really away from doing these small things. The state was really just paving the roads for people to work. And this is really what we want to promote in the Constitution. To take shortcut to future open sourcing is the only way. Actually, we cannot afford accept this and be innovative, be resilient. Thank you. I don't know if we open the question now, if you want, or... Yeah, we can do this.
You're the chairman.
You are the chair.
Actually not. This is part of the convention that we really want. So, any question? Please.
Just a question. You are talking about the PREV and the new communities and the new buildings. But is there any solution to these solutions that you talked about are applicable on the already built environment?
They are all applicable. They have a point, one and a point. We are doing always in parallel two things. One is really to develop the product, so we have hands on the innovation of the product. So we have this as an Egyptian innovation. This is the first, even if we imported the idea, even if we imported some of the concepts and techniques. But we have really to localize this. This is the first thing. The second thing is really to pave the road in the market. So market development is a vital. So when we want really to push the solar water heater, we have really to launch a national program to promote solar water heater. And it could, because it is win-win situation. Banks, Ministry of Finance, stakeholders like customers, sellers, traders, everybody is really winning. So there's no obstacle, only the framework conditions. And I think it is changing now.
In terms of the costs, with regard to the building, how do the costs, are the technologies that you're talking about suitable for high-rise buildings, or some of them obviously are, but how do the costs compare to the standard informal, 8 to 10 story, okay? How do the costs compare to the standard construction, but to the cost of constructing an informal, 8-10 story building?
Why informal should be 8 floors actually? This is
it is. I don't know why. I mean, because of the cost.
In this case, it is okay to work with concrete. This is not the problem. Actually, the problem is to have the possibility and capacity to innovate for the needs. And this would keep the community really healthy. So, for example, the grey water recycling units could work for certain kind of clients, definitely. We broadened this clients as much as we can in this prototype. But at the end of the day, if another client just shown up, then we work for them, with them. Definitely we are flexible as innovation networks. Also, to this is not mentioned before, is the innovation network is putting the action plan, putting the objectives collectively. We are working collectively So whatever upcoming problems should be tackled. We are not solving every problem by this. This is only introduction of what we can do. Any other question? Please.
Thanks for the presentation. I think as Hassan was just saying, the first step, this group, are brought together in one maybe survey, and it would be interesting to see how they can really be integrated in one comprehensive solution, not as possibly global solutions. That it's not a mix and match in principle. It's it has to work together one way or another in certain situations. And there are, to solve the issue of the sewage, wastewater, and solid waste, there are different solutions which might be different, appropriately different from one context to another. And I wonder how that survey is actually dealing not with only surveying innovation concept, but actually trying to work with actual cases where energy could be saved, water could be saved by using economically feasible, socially and culturally acceptable solution. Because otherwise, they will just remain at the level and the seat of being innovatively produced, practically not used.
Actually, this is the manner we're working with. Like, for example, we have these networks, but also we have iHouse Innovation Network as a really framework network that really coordinates between this all. So none of these technology is not really fitting the planning, the first planning I show you, for example. Our idea is really to engage as much as we can from stakeholders. Also, HPRC is part of this network. HPRC is part of the iHouse Innovation Network, and we're really looking forward to be involved in the planning and really assigning these technologies in BLEF. I'm not sure if we will be having this opportunity or not, but we are offering the process actually. So it is integrated at the end of the day, as you said. And we are offering the possibility of really going to certain contexts. For example, Dr. Ahmed Rashid from the British University, they had a very nice innovative competition to identify points around Egypt to be like starting points for cities or for even sustainable communities. Dr. Ahmed Rashid joined Italy and so on. So we are really creating this very vivid structures connected to each other, and definitely we want to do it in one of the projects, but not only, but really to show people that you can innovate even beyond this. This is not, this is only samples of people can, how people can really solve their problem in Egypt by Egyptian brains. But I agree totally with you. Thank you. It seems that then. Thank you.